Yes, so very good morning. Right, so let us discuss one more set of MCQs. Right, so if you come to the ICI website under the Students Board of Studies Knowledge Portal, right, you have it there for the old course and the new course. Right, in the new course, the sample questions for the 30-70 assessment, in that the sample questions one, right, for 2-3, I've already uploaded the videos. Okay, so right now, this one, right, sample questions one, right, that is the 50 questions of MCQ, right, so 25 I will discuss in this video and 25 in the next video. Right, so, and many of these MCQs are similar, rather I can say 90% are similar, 90 to 95 for the old course and the new course. Okay, so these particular videos are very much relevant for the old course students also. Right, so let's start looking into these MCQs. I hope by now you might have learned the knack, you know, you might have developed the knack of writing or guessing the right answers for the MCQs. Okay. Right, so these ones are very simple. Looking at these questions, sometimes the thought comes, is this for final or have I opened the file for intermediate? Okay, right. The basic assumption underlying the use of analytical procedures is, right, so basic assumption underlying the use of analytical procedures. So that reminds me first of SA 520. Right, it helps the auditor to study relationship among elements of financial information. Okay, relationship, it helps you, the basic assumption that relationship among data exist and continue in the absence of known evidence to the contrary. Analytical procedures will not be able to detect unusual relationships and none of the above. Right, so analytical will not help to detect unusual relationship. No, that won't be. Right, so analytical will not help to detect unusual relationships, no. Right, it rather helps you to detect unusual relationship, none of the above, no. It helps the auditor to study relationship among elements of financial information, not only financial but also the non-financial information. So this one also won't be the correct one. So it helps, it's on the basic assumption that whether any the relationship among data exists and continue in the absence of known evidence to the contrary. Okay, right, next one, right, direct confirmation procedures are performed during audit of accounts receivable balances to address the following balance sheet assertion. They are asking that for debtors you send confirmation for which particular assertion, right, rights and obligation, valuation, completeness, existence, right. So, you know, in the explanation of SA 505, it is said that, you know, that external confirmations provide a very strong evidence to the assertion of existence rather than to the assertion of valuation. Because, you know, when the debtor, creditor, they reply, that means first thing they exist, it's not fake. Now, whether they confirm the right amount or the wrong amount valuation, there are other ways and means to check those. But main first thing is the debtor exists or the creditor exists. Right? So, which balance sheet assertion over here? It is going to be existence. Right? Which balance sheet assertion? Existence. Okay. Right. Third one. The auditor shall express a dash opinion when the auditor, having obtained sufficient appropriate audit evidence, concludes that misstatements individually or in the aggregate are both material and pervasive to the financial statements. So he has obtained evidence and he concludes that the misstatements individually or in the aggregate are both material and pervasive. So material misstatement, material but not pervasive, qualified, and material and pervasive, adverse opinion. So much of material misstatement that these financial statements cannot be considered to be true and fair. Right? So adverse, qualified, disclaimer, clean, right? This would lead to a adverse opinion. Why? Because it is material misstatement and material and pervasive. Right, material misstatement, material and pervasive. Right, next one. The agreed terms of audit engagement shall be recorded in an audit engagement letter. So SA 210, which shall include the following except. Right, so contents of audit engagement letter. Responsibilities of the auditor, yes. Description of the methods to be followed for obtaining audit evidence, doesn't seem to be right. Responsibilities of the management, yes, we do mention it in the engagement letter. Objective and scope of the audit of financial statements, yes. So what we don't write in the engagement letter, the description of the methods to be followed in obtaining the audit evidence, right? So which is the correct answer over here? B. Okay, right. I told you very simple ones, right? But sometimes simple questions also you do the wrong answers because of overconfidence. Okay, the measure of the quality of audit evidence about its relevance and reliability in providing support for the conclusions on which the auditor's opinion is based is, yes, quality of audit evidence means sufficiency, appropriateness, accounting estimates, or reasonableness of audit evidence. Obviously, quality means we are talking about the appropriateness of the audit evidence, right? Appropriateness, right? Sufficiency refers to the quantity and appropriateness refers to the quality of the audit evidence. Next one. The auditor's dash safeguards the auditor's ability to form an audit opinion without being affected by any influences. Right, so what safeguards, you know, the auditor's ability to form an audit opinion without being affected by any influences means there is no subjectivity. He is giving an objective opinion, an unbiased opinion, an impartial opinion, not influenced by others. Right, so objectivity, independence, confidentiality, integrity. I think confidentiality straight away out. Right, integrity also won't come. What may come to your mind is also objectivity along with independence. Okay, but see, when you are independent, that keeps you in a position so that you are objective. Independence comes first. So independence safeguards the auditor's ability to form an opinion without being affected by any influences. If you are independent, you will be able to be objective. You can't be objective when you are not independent. Do you follow that? Right. So first, that is why we have identified the threats to the independence of the auditor. And there are steps which are required to be taken to reduce or eliminate those threats. Right. And once the auditor is independent, there is more possibility, that's more possible for him to be objective, to be considered to be of integrity and all. Okay. Right. Next one. Which of the following company is not exempted from CARO? Right, so which are the companies which are exempted from CARO? Banking company, CARO not applicable. Insurance company, CARO not applicable. Section 8 companies, CARO not applicable. So these companies, they are exempted from CARO. So which is a company which is not exempted from CARO? Private limited company having paid up capital of 5 crore. What is the limit for private limited company? Paid up share capital and reserves and surplus not exceeding 1 crore as on the balance sheet date. And you are only paid up capital is 5 crore. So obviously to this company CARO is going to be applicable. Next one, section 144 of the Companies Act 2013 does not exclude the statutory auditor of the company to render the services of, right? So does not exclude. So which it does not allow? Investment advisory services, not allowed as per section 144. Investment advisory, investment banking services, not allowed. Right? Branch auditor, I don't think it is there in the list of nine services given under 144. Right? What are the services over there? Accounting and bookkeeping, internal audit, design and implementation of financial information system, outsourced financial services, investment advisory services, investment banking services, actuarial services, management services, and any other kind of services as may be prescribed. Right? So branch auditor, not there. Actuarial, again, section statutory auditor cannot provide, section 144. Right? So branch auditor, yes, can the statutory auditor also be the auditor of the branch? Can the statutory auditor also be the auditor of the branch? Yes, right? So the correct answer over there is C. Right. As per SA 550 on related parties, existence of which relationship indicate the presence of control or significant influence? Right. So 550, existence of which relationship indicate the presence of control or significant influence? Right. Friend of a family member of a person who has the authority and the responsibility for planning. Friend of a family member. Does friend come in the definition of relative? No. Right. Holding debentures in the entity. Right. The entity is holding of debentures in other entities. Right. So debenture does not give you any decision making, you know, any equity or any voting rights over there. Right. So friend, debentures, no. The entity is holding of equity in other entities. Obviously, that is going to make it your related party. So no friend, no debentures, only equity. Right. No friend, no debentures, only equity. That will make it the presence of control or significant influence. Right. Next one. When does an auditor shall modify the opinion in the audit report? So essay 705. When based on the audit evidence obtained, the financial statements are not free from material misstatement. Yes, we have to modify our opinion. When unable to obtain evidence to conclude that the financial statements as a whole are free from material misstatement, again, yes, even in this case, we modify our opinion. First case, we issue qualified or an adverse opinion. Second one, we issue a qualified or a disclaimer of opinion. C, A and B both, and D, either A or B. Right? So obviously it's either A or B. It not has to be that you are, there is a material misstatement and there is a limitation on scope. Any one of the two also, you need to modify the opinion. Right? So the correct answer over there is D. Right? Yes, you're paying attention. Right, next one. For a given level of audit risk, the acceptable level of detection risk bears an dash relationship to the assessed RMM. Right, so risks of material misstatement we assess and detection risk we manage. The higher the detection risk, the lower the detection risk has to be. The higher the RMM, the lower you have to lower the detection risk. And the lower the RMM, the higher the detection risk can be kept. Right, so that means there is an inverse relationship. You say, madam, all this we know from intermediate. Right, there's an inverse relationship between RMM and detection risk. Right, higher the RMM, lower the detection risk, and lower the RMM, higher could be the detection risk. Next one. Control activities, whether within IT or manual systems, have various objectives and are applied at various organizational and functional levels. Which of the following is an example of control activities? Okay, so we have the five components of internal control in SA 315, CRISM, right? Control environment, risk assessment, information system and communication, control activities and the monitoring. And why all the control activities are defined? So that all the control objectives in the organization are achieved, right? Why are control activities defined? So that the control objectives are achieved. That whatever you want to achieve by designing that control, accordingly you need to design an activity, right? So should there be authorization designed, right? Should there be proper authorization? Yes. Performance review, the work of one being reviewed by another, okay. Information processing, at each stage some processing of the transaction is required to be done. Authorization, like, you know, say preparation of purchase order, then processing the purchase invoice, then the accounting voucher. So information processing and all of the above, right? So all these three are control activities, right? Authorization, that has to be done. Performance review has to be done. Information processing also, yes. So the correct answer over here is D, right? Next one. Right, if as a result of the misstatement resulting from fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question his ability to continue to performing the audit. You know, this is what we write towards the end of our case studies for SA 240. And then later on, after you finish seeing this video, what you do, you go back, right, to the case studies of SA 240 in whichever book you are studying from, and then you will find, you know, if as a result of the misstatement resulting from fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question the auditor's ability to continue to performing the audit. This is the sentence given over there. The auditor needs to consider two things. One, whether it is appropriate to withdraw from the engagement, and second, determine the professional legal responsibilities. Right, and withdrawal is not permissible, right, then in that case what he needs to do, professional legal responsibilities, and if he withdraws, the reasons for withdrawal to be communicated to PCWG. Right, so this comes at the end of the case studies of SA 240 whenever there is a question regarding any management fraud or any fraud. Right. So, if as a result of the misstatement resulting from fraud, the auditor encounters exceptional circumstances that bring into question his ability to continue performing the audit, he says, such a big fraud, now I cannot do the audit anymore. What shall he do? Withdraw from the engagement immediately, report to audit team regarding the withdrawal, determine the professional and legal responsibilities applicable in the circumstances, ask the management for his withdrawal. So no question of asking management for withdrawal, right? No reporting to audit team as such. So these two are just fillers. withdraw from the engagement immediately? No, there is a procedure which is required to be followed. So determine, so now what to do? Fraud has been identified. So determine the professional and legal responsibilities. Right? Determine the professional and legal responsibilities. Okay, next one, 14. In order to form an opinion, the auditor shall conclude as to whether the auditor has obtained the, oh my God, this is like, has to be reasonable assurance about whether the financial statements as a whole are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error, right? SA 200, the overall objective, right? Reasonable assurance that financial statements are free from material misstatement. No absolute assurance. Why? Due to the inherent limitations of an audit. Limited assurance we give in case of a review engagement, right? And then none of the above. No, this is not the option. Next one, right? Question number 15. When is evidential matter generally considered sufficient in case of stock exchange member audit? Now, first, when you see stock exchange member audit, it comes to your mind option. Okay, but then it's an MCQ, so we can attempt. When is evidential matter, whatever evidence you obtain in the audit, considered sufficient in case of stock exchange member audit? So evidence which you get, when will you consider, okay, I think it's enough. Okay, when it constitutes entire population, that is you do 100% checking, I think okay, it can be considered sufficient in that case. When it is objective and relevant, obviously that case we would more consider it to be appropriate than sufficient. When it is objective and relevant, relevant talks about the quality. When it is enough to provide a basis for giving reasonable assurance regarding the truthfulness. And when auditor collects and evaluates it independently, right? So collects and evaluates it independently is again going to be about the quality, right? So when it is enough to provide a basis for giving the reasonable assurance regarding the truthfulness. So to be very honest, there is nothing over here as such for stock exchange member audit. Had it been mutual fund, depository or NBFC, any other audit, when would it be sufficient? When it is enough to provide a basis for giving the reasonable assurance regarding the truthfulness. Okay, right. So the correct answer over there is C. Right, that is 15. Right, coming to 16. The scope of the audit of depositories, including reference to the pronouncements of ICAI, which the auditor adheres to, generally is communicated to the client in. So, you know, when you're doing an audit of depositories, your terms of engagement in reference to the pronouncements of ICAI, how you're going to go about the audit, scope of audit, right, what all areas you will cover is communicated to the client in the audit report, engagement letter, representation letter. Right, so the auditor's report, will you mention about the scope of audit that we have conducted our audit in accordance with the standards on auditing? Okay, engagement letter, will we mention that we will conduct our audit in accordance with the standards on auditing? And representation letter also, right? Representation letter also, is it required to be communicated? Right, in the representation also we need to mention. Right, the management would mention that they are aware of the fact that the auditor is going to do the audit in accordance with the standards and that no guarantee for fraud error detection. Right, so what is the correct answer over here? D, yes, which is all of the above, right? Audit report, engagement letter and the representation letter. Right, scope of audit is mentioned, the objective and scope of audit. Right, so in representation also the management makes it clear regarding what is their responsibility, what is the auditor's responsibility. Next one, which of the following information should a successor auditor obtain during the inquiry of the predecessor auditor before accepting the engagement? Right, so incoming auditor, outgoing auditor, right? The incoming auditor, what information, what inquiry should he make of the outgoing auditor before accepting the engagement? Information about the integrity of the management. I think that is one of the points which we check while doing acceptance of a new client. Right, disagreement with the management concerning the auditing procedures. So that reminds me of any limitation on scope if it has been imposed by the management. Review of internal control system, organization structure. Right, so now see, review of internal control system, organization structure, that incoming auditor, you can check on your own. Why do you need to ask the outgoing auditor? You know, but are there any concerns about the integrity of the management? Did they impose any limitation on the scope of your work? Was there any disagreement regarding the auditing procedures? Right, for these matters, you have to make inquiry with the outgoing auditor, right? The predecessor auditor, right? So one and two, Right? No internal control system, no organization structure to ask to outgoing auditor. When you come for audit, you check it on your own. Okay. Right. Yes. Question number 18. In an investigation relating to possible misappropriation of cash, the cashier says that every day the cash is counted and is reviewed by the finance head. Your specimen review indicates that the daily cash summary was not signed off by the finance head. So cash is counted every day and then it is to be signed by the finance head. It is not being signed. In this situation, right, in an investigation to a possible misappropriation of cash. So already there is a indication of fraud. That is why our investigation is being conducted. Conclude that cashier is not telling truth. Consider extending investigation procedures like corroborative inquiry with the finance head, review of appropriate daily cash summaries, etc. Conclude that the finance head is not a responsible person. Conclude that daily cash summary is not relevant for the investigation. So it's not relevant. Obviously, when I'm checking for misappropriation of cash, cash summary has to be relevant. Right, consider that cashier is not telling truth. There is no reason for you to conclude that. Right, conclude that finance head is not a responsible person, but concluding that is not going to be of any use for me. Right, so consider extending investigation procedures like corroborative inquiry with the finance head, review of the appropriate daily cash summaries, etc. Next one, current period adjustments are those adjustments that are made, right? Next one, current period adjustment. So all of a sudden, which chapter? Audit of consolidated financial statements, right? So current period adjustments are those adjustments that are made only on the first occasion of the preparation and presentation of consolidated financial statements. No, those I think are permanent consolidation adjustments, which are prepared only on the, done only on the first occasion. Only on the first occasion on the audit of the consolidated financial statements? No. Right. In the accounting period for which the consolidation of financial statements is done, right? So that means every time when consolidation is being done, consolidation of financial statements is being done, these current period adjustments would be done and none of the above? No. Right. So A and B is about permanent consolidation adjustments. D is none of the above. So C is the correct answer. In the accounting period for which the consolidation of the financial statements is done. Even though in A, B, C, anywhere, you know, you find out the correct answer, please maintain that discipline that you read the remaining options also. Like, you know, you read a question and you find that A is the correct answer. But still, as a procedure, as a discipline, you have to read B, C, D also. Okay, right, next one, 20. Which of the following best suits the description? The susceptibility of an assertion that could be material either individually or in aggregate before consideration of any related internal control. So possibility of a misstatement before consideration of controls, that is obviously the inherent risk. It is not detection risk, it is not control risk. Detection risk is the procedures performed will not detect a misstatement. And control risk is that there is a possibility of a misstatement which will not be prevented, detected, corrected on a timely basis by the entity's internal control. And D, just because they have to complete the A, B, C, D, none of the above. Right? So which is the correct answer over here? A, which is inherent risk. Okay. Next one. B, a chartered accountant in practice, availed of a loan against his personal investments from a bank. He issued two checks towards the repayment of the said loan as per the installments due. However, both the checks were returned back by the bank with the remarks insufficient funds as per the Chartered Accountants Act, under which clause CAD is liable for misconduct. Right? So check of the CA has been dishonored due to insufficiency of funds. Right? So this comes in the list of illustrative examples for other misconduct. Right, so in this case, the chartered accountant D is going to be guilty of other misconduct. Okay, they have mentioned only misconduct. So he's going to be guilty of other misconduct under 611, 212, 1211 or 241. Right, so disrepute in the opinion of the council brings disrepute to the profession or to the institute as a result of his action, whether or not related to his professional work, that comes under 241. Right, what is 611? Solicits. Right, what is 212? Right, breach of confidentiality for CAs in practice. What is 1211? Signing. right, allows persons not being a CA, not being a, being a CA but not being his partner, right, to sign on his behalf or on behalf of his firm any balance sheet, profit and loss, report on financial statements, right? So which is the correct option over here? D. Right. Next one. As an auditor appointed under Section 44AB of the Income Tax Act 1961, under which clause of Form 3CD? Now, these are going to be nightmare for you in the exam. Okay, for ethics, if they ask you the clause, or for CARO, if they ask you the clause, you know, it's going to be like a cakewalk. But tax audit or the GST or 9C also, if they ask you under which clause or under which serial number do you do the reporting, right, that's going to be more tricky. Jiggy means if you study it, you'll know it. If you don't study, what you'll know? Okay, right. As an auditor appointed under Section 44AB of the Income Tax Act, under which clause of Form 3CD you will report for amounts deemed to be profits and gains under 32AC, 33AB or 33ABA or 33AC? Right, so this is all the tea cup, tea coffee rubber, right, all the 32 allowances over there, right? So does it come under 40, 24, 40, 31 or 23, right? So what is 40? 40 is the accounting ratios in Form 3CD. 31, loan accepted repaid of more than 20,000 other than by account pay, check or draft, or payment or receipt of more than 2 lakh, right? 23 is regarding the payments to the related parties, right? So the correct answer, the deemed profits and gains under 32-33 comes under clause 24 of Form 3CD. Okay, next one. As per CARO, the auditor is required to report whether the company is required to be registered under Section 45IA of the RBI Act. If so, whether the registration has been obtained. Right, so 45IA of the RBI Act, whether certificate of registration has been obtained. Rather, this is the last clause in CARO, right? 16 clauses in CARO. So is it clause 11, clause 16, clause 15 or 14? Right, so this is the last clause. So this is clause 16 of CARO. Right, what is 11? Right, 11 is regarding the managerial remuneration. Right, what is 15? 15 is regarding the non-cash transactions and 14 is regarding the preferential allotment. Right, so which is the correct option over there? B. Next one. As per clause 1C, so now reverse style. Now they've given the clause, you have to know the content. As per clause 1C of para 3, so clause 1, fixed assets, under that 3 points, A, B, C. Right, so of para 3 of CARO 2016, the auditor is required to report on whether title deeds of immovable properties are held in the name of the company, if not, provide the details thereof. Rather, that is clause 1C. Right, title deeds of immovable properties, but let's see the other three. Whether the company has entered into non-cash transactions with directors or persons connected? No, that is clause 15. Whether any fraud by the company or any fraud on the company by its officers or employee noticed or reported during the year? If yes, the nature and amount involved is to be indicated? No, that is clause 10. Whether the company is maintaining proper records showing full particulars including quantitative details and situation of fixed assets? Right, that is clause 1A, that is not clause 1C, right, so not D, right, so the correct option over here is A, right, and the last one for this video, 25th one. LN Limited has obtained a term loan of rupees 300 lakh from a bank for the construction of a factory. Since there was a delay in the construction activities, the said funds were temporarily invested in short-term deposits, under which clause of CARO the auditor is required to report. Right, so this is regarding the end use of monies raised, right, clause 9, right, what was the money raised for construction of a factory and where it has been invested in the short-term deposits, right, so clause 8, clause 8 is regarding what, right, clause 8 is regarding the repayment of dues, right, clause 9, 11 is regarding the managerial remuneration, right, 10 is regarding the fraud and 9 is regarding the end use of monies raised. Right, so clause 9 is regarding the end use of monies raised. So the correct answer over here is D. Right, the other 25, right, there are total 50 in this particular file. Right, so the other 25, we'll see it in the next one. Yes, thank you.